Hello and welcome to this tutorial on how to use Fusion 360 CAM in order to machine with your own DIY 2D wire EDM machine. Let's have a look how we can machine this workpiece. This workpiece is a piece of jewelry. It's going to be a hanger or a bracelet. Not sure about that yet. Anyway, it's a small heart. That is supposed to be machined out of brass, so we can polish it for a nice shine. If you are going to machine this with an EDM machine, you need to make three cuts. The inside top contour, and the inside bottom contour, and the outside contour. So we are going to make three different G-code files instead of making one file. Because if you make one file and run it, you do not have time to stop the machine and re-thread the wire. So because you have to jump from the top to the bottom and from the bottom to the outside of the workpiece. So we are going to make three individual G-code files. For each cut, one file. So how do we do this? Well, Autodesk Fusion, if I have not mentioned it before, I think is the way to go for EDM. I especially like the all the features it has. It is really feature rich and incredibly, even though it's free. So you can get a startup license. If you have a small company or if you are a hobbyist, you can get a free startup license. Go to the Autodesk Fusion website to check out how you can do that. So yeah, you can really use this software for completely free if you're a small company or hobbyist. So that's amazing. A lot of features. And for EDM, for the CAM features, the only features or the only operation that I'm going to use is the 2D profile operation. So let's select this operation. And then a new setup appears here. So here's the configuration screen for this particular operation. And yeah, you basically go through all the things that you need to fill in. And that's it. So let's go through these different things. So we start out with the tool, the first tab here. A tool. Well, no tool is selected, so we need to select one. We click that. You can select from a whole bunch of tools, but you need to select a laser cutter. So this tool does not exist. You need to make it yourself. So let me delete this one here. Deleting the laser cutter. And deleting this one here as well. So this is the screen that you would start out with. An empty screen. It can be in your local library. Oh, here I also have a laser cutter. Let's remove the laser cutter. Okay. So you start out with anything and you do not have the laser cutter while you need it. So you need to add one. So you right click on the library. You select a new cutting tool. And then you select the laser cutting tool. Start with the first tab here. Not really important. You can leave any everything empty. The cutter, we select a laser cutter with a curve width of 0.317. This curve width will likely be different on your machine. For each setting you use, or material type, or flushing conditions, the curve width will be affected. So prior to making your part, you should first machine a part of exactly 10 times 10 millimeters square, or any known width and thickness, and then machine it. And basically what you end up with is a square that is not 10 by 10 when you measure it, but it's smaller. So you can deduce what the curve width is. So you first need to do an experiment. Then you know what your curve width is, and you fill it in for your next cut. So you basically only need to do this once if you do not change your EDM settings. So I have already predetermined that for this piece that I'm going to cut, My curve width is 0.317 millimeters. Nozzle clearance, you don't need to fill anything in, just leave it at 4. Holder, not relevant. Feeds and speeds, well, these are feeds and speeds for lasers, so these are really high. So you should change everything to 50. 50, 50, 50. Well, in fact, the machine itself will determine the correct feed rate automatically because it's an EDM machine. But you should start out with something known and realistic, which is 50. Then the post-processor, you do not have to fill anything in here. Just leave it empty and click OK. So now we have a laser cutter. So what we just did, you only need to do that once. And then it's in your tool list and you can use it the next time if you want to cut something that has the same curve width. So now we select the laser cutter. It's selected here now. Cutting mode, not relevant. You can leave it like it is. Feeds and leads in, lead out, everything on 50, which it automatically fills in as it draws these numbers from your tool that you have just defined. So that's good as well. The next tab is the geometry. We are going to select the contour. Now, so contour selection, if you hover over a contour, so you can select it. So for the outside contour, it identifies it, as you can see. If I hover over it with my mouse cursor, you can see that it turns blue, so I can select it. So now I have selected this outside contour, which is great because that's the contour that I want to machine. So it might have difficulties finding the correct contour, as you will see in a few minutes, because it cannot find the contour for the lower part. So there is a trick on how you can do that. So we have chosen the contour here, loops, just leave it at all loops, side, start outside. You can leave it at that. If you make a wrong decision here, you will see it in the toolpath. I will show you in a few minutes. So we basically, on this tab, we only pick the contour selection, and then we move on to heights. Heights are not relevant, so you can leave. You do not have to change any of these numbers. Just leave them. Passes are, so the only relevant thing here is the compensation. So you should choose here in computer. Well, you could also do it in control, and then it will use the G42 and G43 tool correction codes. But my advice would be to do it in computer, because you have specified the tool offset by setting your curve width in the tool here. So you can leave it here, and then it's also easy to see if the tool path is on the correct side of the cut, on the inside or the outside. Stock to leave, nothing smooth, nothing, you can leave it like this. Linking, not relevant, leads. So unselect that, we do not need any leads. Keep it really simple. Entry position. Now that's an interesting one. So entry position is where it should start on the contour. And in this example, I want my entry position for the outside. I want it to be here, there. So I select a point and then I click OK. And there is my toolpath. And as you can see, the toolpath is on the wrong side. It's on the inside. So I need to change that. The toolpath is on the inside of the heart. So let's change it. If I go to edit, I select the toolpath. It's selected now. And then here you see a red arrow. So if the path is on the wrong side, you click the red arrow. And then it changes where it's machining. So I press OK again, OK. And now the path is on the outside. So this is already the correct path for the outside contour of the heart. Let's move on to the second contour and do this inside top contour right here. So again, I press cutting, select the contour. Select the tool first, which we have defined already. So I can move on to the next tab where I select the contour. And if you see, if I select it here, it doesn't recognize it. But if I try another point here, this you can see the entire contour turns black. So that's good. So you need to move around your contour a bit. And then finally, yeah, it will recognize it. So you click the contour. And I'm not sure if the arrow is pointing now in the correct direction. Might be the wrong way around. But we can see that when we finish the cut. And you can see it because you choose compensation type in control. If you choose computer here, path will be exactly on the on the model, and you cannot see it. So that's another advantage of choosing in control. So I just chose the path, and that's okay. Then height's not relevant. Passes, I choose in computer. And linking, not relevant. Turn the leads off. Okay, let's show it. Okay, it's on the inside, as you can see. So that's good. So that's our second profile. Now we do the third profile, this one. Again, we press on 2D profile. We select the tool that we want. Good. Next tab. We select the contour. And now it's not working. See, I'm moving around and I want to contour around the inside here. I'm selecting it, but it cannot find it. So now I use the contour tool. In order to do so, you click a small piece first, and then a line appears, and then click that line again, and then you get a little menu here. And then you click a few more points on the line. This one, this one. And eventually, you'll get around. Let's see here, this one, this one. Ah, now it finds the entire contour. So now it's closed. And when it's closed, you press the green plus. And that's it. The contour has been selected. Now we go to heights, not relevant. We go to, what's this called, passes. Again, in computer for the correction. The last tab we go to leads, you turn it off, turn this off. I have forgotten to define the entry positions for the inside cuts. So let's do this entry position here. So I'm going to drill a hole right here, and I'm going to drill a hole right here for the wire. So this entry position, I would like to have this corner here. So now you can see it has selected that point. So that's the entry position. So I press OK, wait for it to generate, check if the path is on the correct side, which it is. And now for the other profile, see, now the entry point is here. I don't like that. I want my entry point to be right there because it makes it more convenient. So I edit the cut where my entry point should be. Here it says nothing. I select this edge. That's my entry point now. Regenerate. Oh, nice. So actually now I have three profiles. I have the outside, the inside top, and the inside bottom. So that's good. Now there's one thing that we still need to define. As you can see now, there is a coordinate system floating around here. So that is the work coordinate system. But this for me is an inconvenient position. I do not like to have the 0, 0 position right here. In fact, I want to have the 0, 0 position right on that corner. Because then I know if I drill a hole here, I can move the wire along the x-axis or the y-axis. I see here the axes are revolved as well, so this is not convenient. I want to machine the heart in this direction. So as if I'm standing in front of the machine. So I want this to be my x-axis, and I want this direction to be my y-axis. And these are switched now. And I want this to be my zero origin. So I need to change my coordinate system here. Now, how do you do that? You right-click on Setup, Edit, and then you get the setup or the controls to change the work coordinate system. As you can see now, it is set up to be at the origin of the stock right here. But that's not really relevant for me. I want my coordinate system right over there, and you can select any point that you want. So let's change it here. Let me first delete this. And I want to say, I want my origin to be a selected point. So let's have my origin right there. And then I don't like it that the Y is in this direction. So I want to select my X and Y axes. So first I select, so you do that by selecting that in orientation. First I select my X axes, and that would be along this way. Then I select my Y axes, which would be along this way. And now the x-axis is pointing in the wrong direction. I like it to point to the right in order to be positive, so I can click it. Now it's good. So if you click an arrow, it switches direction. For instance, if I switch the Y here, this side or this side. So if I'm standing in front of my machine, Y is up, X is to the right, and Z is to the top. So negative Z would be into the workpiece. So this is how I like my coordinate system to be defined. So now if I drill two holes, one hole would be at X0 and Y1, just about, and the other hole would be around here, a few millimeters lower. So those are convenient entry holes. And note that I indicated this point and this point as initial startup points for the machining operations inside. So I click OK. Now it shows here these red exclamation marks. Because you changed the coordinate system, you need to regenerate the toolpaths. So now we right click here and say select generate. Yep, that's it. So all toolpaths are finished. And basically, we are ready for post-processing this. So let's start out. Post-process. We right-click here and select. So I'm going to post-process these machining operations individually. So let's do the first one first. Post-process. I right-click and select post-process. And in order to post-process, you need a post-processor, which I have written. I have written a post-processor if you use the DynaMotion CNC controller, which is the CNC controller that I use for my EDM machine. So if you use the same DynaMotion controller or something different, which is a bit similar, then you can use my post-processor. So my post-processor is available on bexedm.com in the download section. You can download a zip, which if you unpack has the post-processor file, I think it's an EPS file inside. Then you can unzip it. And then if you browse to configuration folder, so I have my config file in the folder called BexEDM posts, then you can select it. Let me see here. So now I can select the BexEDM 2D wire EDM post processor. There are some options that you could choose from here. You can leave them all to default. So now if I press post, it will ask me under what file name I want to post. So let's post it here as, the current one is the outside profile. So I can name it outside profile. Outside profile hard. And if I press save, it automatically generates the G code that makes the outside profile. And this G-code you can run for your YEDM machine without any errors on a DynaMotion CNC controller. So what I did was I took the, because Autodesk Fusion 360 does not have a cutting operation for 2D wire EDM. So instead I took a post-processor for laser cutting and I changed it quite a lot. I removed a lot of things, I added some things, and now yeah, it's basically tailored to do 2D wire EDM operations. So it's it has generated the heart, and you can do the same for the other machining operations. So here's the inside profile on the top. So we again press post process. The correct post processor has now already been selected and did it previously. Or you can add a program name here. That's better. So we add here inside profile heart. Okay, post, again, it's good to choose it here because then it not only automatically fills in the file name, it also shows it in the G-code, as you can see here. First line, inside profile heart, that's where it gets back. So now we also have the G-code for the inside profile, or I should have chosen inside profile top, because we also have an inside profile bottom, this one. Let's generate that as well. Post-process, inside profile bottom. We press post, and here it is. Yeah, works beautifully. So now we have these three NC files, which are basically text files with G-code, and we can open these in KMotion CNC. So, not sure where this is saved. Let me save it here on the desktop just for convenience. Desktop, inside profile button. Okay, so it's saved to the desktop. Now, if you open KMotion CNC, this is just an example interface. I'm not running on my machine now. I'm running on another laptop. So I press simulate here. And I can open the G-code, go to the desktop, which is where I just stored it. Where is it? Just a sec. Oh, I thought I saved it to the desktop. Okay. I guess I saved it somewhere else. Anyway, you can open your numeric file here. Open it. And then your G-code is shown in the G-code window of KMotion CNC. And if you press run, it runs through the entire file in the blink of an eye because it's a simulation. But I'm not getting any errors, which means it compiled correctly and you can run this code. Okay, so now that we have our code, the next thing we should do is we should print out a drawing that we can put on the stock material and punch some small holes to the points that we want as entry points so that we can drill in the center punched marks. So in order to make a small drawing, it's really easy. First, let's exit the manufacture mode here and go to the model mode. Then we basically say new drawing, rattles a bit. Hey, where's the new drawing? New drawing, oh, sorry. I should have chosen new drawing from design. Do it again. New drawing from design. Select the paper size here, so it's a standard A4. Then I choose my scale, 1:1. Now you can see the size of the heart, place it in the middle of the paper and go to print. Not doing it now, I already printed it out, but if you press print, then you get your drawing at the correct size. And then you can move on to punching the center mark holes. So that's it for the introduction on how to use CAM for 2D wire EDM machining. So we start out with a piece of flat stock. This is brass. Print out a template. It's just a drawing from Autodesk Fusion. Around the edge here. Seems good. Center punch, some wire hole entries, one here, there, and a small hole for the first entry. Actually, I don't need a hole there, I can go with the wire straight in. But this is my starting point in CAM, so I marked it slightly so that I can see with the wire later where I should position it in order to enter the stock. So the workpiece is clamped to the table and the wire is through the workpiece, through the first hole. Time to start machining. Okay, that's a bit of a time jump. I had some problems filming through cloudy water. I'll add some nice footage of cutting action later in this video. So, re-threaded the wire on the outside of the workpiece. Now it's time for the final cut. The final cut has finished, and as you can see, it turned out quite nice. Now let's see if I can get it out of the hole. Fiddling a bit. Yeah, that's it. And now it's time to start polishing. Here's the polished result. Looks really nice. I polished it with a simple buffing wheel. The EDM already leaves a really smooth surface. But in order to get the full glance of the shine, let's have a look at it outside in the sunlight. It looks a lot better. Here's the shine in all of its glory. Really nice. Actually looks like gold polished brass. But now I notice that the piece is still too thick to be used as a hanger or as a bracelet. So let's cut it in half and make some nice footage while doing so. So the easiest way to cut it in half and to mount it such that it's correctly positioned is to machine the flat side to the stock and then to super glue the part to the stock. Then you know it's exactly square to the wire. And that works beautifully. And that's the final result. So I hope you enjoyed the video and see you next time.